Hi, welcome to Viva Physical Media.
Episode 41.
I'm Kevin.
I'm Emily.
And here we are.
Here we are.
We're here at the place where we do this. A little different day, because we normally do this on Thursdays, so.
They don't really know, though.
I know, but I'm just saying it's a little, maybe if the vibe feels different.
If the vibe feels different, it's because it's a Sunday.
It's because it's a Sunday. Should we be doing this on a Sunday? Is that like a sin or something?
Probably.
I guess depending on your religion.
I'm actually going to talk about girls who love sinning
today.
Wow,
crazy.
Sinful Sunday, baby. Sinful Sunday Viva episode 41.
Should I drop the news in the beginning?
Drop the big bomb.
Right at the top. I mean, it's not news to us because it's something
what
I planned
this,
for
what
a while.
What if this was how you were telling
You're
me?
Like, what? I am going to be leaving at the end of July. So, of course, I won't be sitting here next to Emily, because I'm going on a year-long trip to around the U.S., to France, to Japan, and hopefully other places in between. Our good friend Matt from Matt's Bad Blockbusters, and if you've watched this and listened to my podcast, you may know him from other things. Will be stepping into my shoes. Well, probably not my shoes. I think he's taller. I think he probably has
different shoes.
Probably different shoe size.
Anyway. Yeah, maybe.
So if he wants these,
he'll probably fit in that chair though.
He will definitely fit in this chair.
But who knows? Kevin might send us some on the road little things.
Oh yeah, you're
not pressured to.
Oh yeah, you're not gonna get rid of me that easy.
And I'm really excited for the next chapter of Viva.
I'm excited too. I mean,
Rich
will still be here behind the camera, and
yep.
Rich will be taking over editing duties altogether. So it's gonna be great. My plan is to go to try and hit up video stores around wherever I'm traveling. You know, and I found a couple in Paris, actually, and I was told by someone that there weren't any left in Paris, but there are. There's more than one. And so I'm going to check those out, and hopefully just around the U.S. where we're traveling and stuff. So I'll be sending reports like that. And probably just if I'm, bored or whatever, I'll probably just send in some pics.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, I'm still going to be watching movies, even though I'll be on the road.
Changes are coming, but not for a little bit.
Changes are coming, but it's, but I'm still here for a bit. So if you have any pressing issues you want to bring my way,
now is the time. Also, if you have any things you want to see in the show going forward, mm-hmm. now's a good time to let us know, because we're not going to be doing a whole rehaul of the show, but maybe we'll add some new stuff.
Different segments. Yeah. I know the dog segment's still going to continue.
We're
for
still
sure.
doing that. We might even still continue Raunch versus Rom. I think we will continue Raunch versus Rom.
All right.
If that's okay with you.
I mean, it's okay with me. I mean, I was mainly because it was my blind spot. I don't know if it's, I don't know if it's Matt's blind spot too. But I have a feeling probably.
I'm really excited for you.
Thank you. But right now we're here. We're talking movies.
Yep.
Any big movie news from you?
I went camping, so I don't watch movies for a while.
Oh, yeah.
But then I watched the movies again.
Okay.
Oh, last night I watched the new, Studio 666 movie. Was that good? It was so fun.
Was it fun?
It was fun, and it was good because they really went for it in regards to the effects and the gore and the blood and just projectile vomiting and possession stuff, and you could tell everyone was having a fucking blast. It was a lot of fun.
That's awesome. I had
a really good time with it, so I definitely recommend you guys check out Studio 666. Oh, I watched that thing you do that you talked about either last episode or the episode before. I can't remember. Very good.
I rewatched Bram Stoker's Dracula again the other day, and that movie rules. It's I watched that and I'm like, man, this is top five Coppola for me. Still think Keanu and Winona Ryder are pretty bad in it, but it's so good. All the effects were how they would have been done in the early 1900s. They tried to do all of them practical or not even practical, but in camera, where they would shoot a part, mask it off, rewind the film, flip it, and expose a lot of stuff.
Put their thing down, flip it, and reverse it.
Exactly.
I went to the Beacon and watched Barry Lyndon,
which
was so delightful.
Awesome.
I haven't seen it in so long, but I loved it. That 3 hours flew fucking by. Cozy as fuck. A really funny movie.
It's a funny-ass movie.
If anyone out there is a little I don't know about Barry Lyndon, just based on what you think it's about or the runtime or anything, I would definitely recommend putting it on because it is fantastic. I'm on a roll of watching good shit now. And earlier, right before we filmed this, I just grabbed a big old stack from around the store. So
nice.
Hopefully there'll be some gems in there.
I got a big old stack at home that's just
waiting. Just crying out.
It keeps waiting.
You need to do your thing where you put one in the bedroom DVD player, one in the living room DVD player.
I don't have a TV in my bedroom, But I do have two players on top of each other, so I have two. Yeah. I have a Blu-ray.
I think about that sometimes. You told me that once, and I think about it.
So I'll put two in sometimes, and then I'll be doing something else because I'll put two in and go like, I don't know which one I want to watch.
We'll see. We'll
but when I out. Sit down, I can be like, you know what I'm in the mood for? The one, whatever one's on top. Unless I forget, and then I have to like check both of them. Yeah.
Or let fate decide.
Yeah, who knows?
I know. Yeah, and then sometimes that's good. That's what you have to do. Oh, I want to give a shout out to Brian on Pure Cinema on their Patreon episode. They gave us a shout out, and he recommended, because he, for his Discovery Zero, recommended Los Reyes based on our recommendation. And
just kidding right there.
And, you know, if you've seen the episode where we talked about Los Reyes, you know how much we love it. And I've talked about it nonstop every other episode. And
so
it's
get
great.
On it.
So
man.
If you haven't seen it yet, check it out. Look up Los Reyes. Not only we recommend it, but Brian from Pure Cinema also recommends it. So, you know.
So no excuse.
No excuses now for any of you. We made our goal.
We made our
fundraising goal. So thank you everyone who donated. We made our $75,000. So yay.
We have a Bigfoot section up in the store right now.
Oh, we do.
That's pretty fun.
I'll get a shot of it and put it up here.
It's very textural.
It's Leo really went all out for it.
And as he would, you know, like I wouldn't expect anything less.
If you're on our YouTube page here, you can hunt around. I think there's only one, but there will be more Project Bigfoot updates, Operation Bigfoot updates as it goes. So check out Leo's Operation Bigfoot intro on this YouTube page.
Or come into the store if you're
he has
around.
A website too.
And then there's a website. It's operationbigfoot.com.
I didn't know that was going to be real.
Yeah. So that'll be in the links at the below too, is operationbigfoot.com.
Also mark your calendars for July 28th.
That's it, yeah.
Because we will be presenting Bingo at the Beacon Cinema. Bingo, if you recall, is a one of our earlier wacky dog movies, and it's going to be so much fun to see with the crowd. So if you're in the area, definitely free that day up and come hang out and drink beers and watch
Bingo with
us. Watch everything that Bingo accomplishes.
It's going to be fun, and we're going to have, there's definitely going to be Bingo trading cards, and there's going to be some other fun stuff too.
Yeah.
So it'll be a fun night. That's what we got coming up, but you know.
Yeah.
Coming up next, let's do the show.
Okay.
Nothing can stop a dog like Bingo.
Whoa. That was a lot. That was a good range from all of us, I think, there.
Yeah. That was gorgeous.
Welcome to Mailbag.
Welcome to Mailbag.
We have a couple. We don't have a big mailbag this time, but we got a couple mailbags.
Stopped writing to us, so
well, yeah.
Whatever.
But you're gonna write to us now, right? Okay. So first off, we got a couple postcards. We got this one, because I don't know if you remember, I showed off the other mystery postcards we got before.
Mm-hmm.
We got this one, and then it says, Emalie and Kevin, have you seen this dog movie yet?
But it's important to note that they started writing my name wrong, and then they wrote my name right. And I really appreciate that.
And then they wrote here, this is a copycat postcard. So they didn't want to pretend, to be like the person who's been sending the mystery postcards.
Which I also, the honesty of this postcard is frankly very impressive.
And I believe this is probably Lassie or something. And I have not watched Lassie yet. Although I did watch Lassie, you know, reruns on TV when I was a kid.
I think I watched the 90s remake of the Lassie movie.
Oh, okay. But this is Liz Taylor, I think. Yeah, because she was in one of those Lassie movies, I believe. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So anyway, no, we have not. But I mean, you know, we'll throw it on the list. You know, like I said, I'm leaving, but I only have a few left. But
that doesn't mean he has to stop watching dog movies for the rest of his life.
Absolutely, absolutely.
I mean, I'm gonna tell him what dog movies we're watching, and maybe he'll watch them.
If I can find them, I will. Probably not.
Here's a legit.
And here's another one. So we got this one, and then this one. Oh, and this is actually. It says, don't go changing. And this is, like, hard to talk about this after I just announced a major change.
I'm scared of the next postcard we're going to give this person.
This is from the mystery postcard.
Because the stamp.
Because you can tell it's the same stamps. I think the handwriting, too.
It's from Seattle.
Yeah, so was the second one. Yeah. We don't know who, though.
I mean, we don't have much, like, the clues aren't, like, enough for us to figure out who it is.
Who is this, based on,
Seattle.
So it's someone in Seattle who knows about us and Scarecrow Video. Interesting. You know, and this is just to SCV, not only to us, so this could not even be for us. This could be, like, to Scarecrow, just don't go changing.
Don't change, you guys.
Don't go changing. So, yeah. And you know,
you rock, don't change.
So we won't, or whatever. But anyway, but cool postcards, some monsters fighting each other. One proper email from Troy.
Yeah, I'll read it.
Okay. And I've got the tally here.
Okay. This is from Troy. We were a couple of eps behind, thanks to your recent vacation, but just got caught up. Question, what percentage of dog movies end in new puppies? Excellent question, Troy.
And part of Troy's vacation was that he was here and he brought us beers, but neither of us were here at the time. Or I was here, but he didn't
come bring us beers.
Yeah, and I didn't get to meet him. And so anyway, sorry I missed you, Troy. But thanks for the question. And we actually went through. I don't know the percentage of all dog movies that end in puppies, but we did go through our dog movies. I didn't do a percentage, but I have a tally.
Well, let's think about this. It's episode 41, so we probably have been talking about 41 dog movies. And so, Rich is the smartest. So it's...
Five.
Five out of 41 would be a percentage of...
13%.
All right.
Okay. Five of our movies that we've done ended in puppies being born. And can we remember what they were? No, I didn't write them all.
I thought you were taking notes.
Man's Best Friend.
It was Man's Best Friend.
Turner and Hooch.
Rover Dangerfield. But then we were going to talk about the two that were kind of like that.
Right. And so Beverly Hills... Chihuahua.
The sequel, it shows they have puppies.
At the beginning. So that movie ends with her and the other Chihuahua in, falling in love.
In a relationship.
and so they're going to have puppies. And they do have puppies.
They do. I've seen the cover.
And the other one is Atomic Dog, which the puppies are born in the movie and are sort of what spur on the Atomic Dog. So yeah. I kind of, it's like, they're not, it doesn't end with puppies, but there are puppies.
We're going to count it.
Bingo ends with him with a joke about how he's going to get neutered. So yeah. So Bingo, no puppies in Bingo.
And K-9 ends with them adopting that poodle too. Yeah. They're going to have puppies.
Puppies are going to happen. Like the end of Dracula's Dog. Which doesn't end with puppies being born, but remember it ends on the shot of... the puppy that's been turned into a Dracula.
Oh, yeah.
Looks at the camera and goes, ha! So I'm going to count that one.
We're
going to
count that one. So we'll count that one because... like 14% or something.
Yeah. Not as many...
It's a trope.
Yeah.
But I guess it doesn't...
I think that's still a lot, though. I think if 10 or 12% or 15% of dog movies have that, that's still a significant amount. Because there's... We know for a fact that there's an infinite amount of dog movies...
Right.
So
we do know that for a fact.
12% of infinity is a lot.
Yeah, that's true. That's a lot.
That's absolutely true. Yeah, because you'd think like that's not a lot, but kind of is. And also, like we're saying, like a lot of these end with the it being like,
these dogs. Assumed. Wink, wink.
These dogs
have a family.
Yeah, these dogs boned.
Great question, Troy.
That was a good question.
Really got us thinking.
Ooh, it made us do math, and so a lot of this segment got edited out while we were doing math and looking things up. but that was awesome.
Thanks for your emails. Keep sending them. viva@scarecrow.com. If you have anything you've been like, I should ask Kevin this sometime, you should probably ask Kevin now.
Should probably ask me now.
And then, as always, I also love hearing from you.
Yes.
And you can send us little videos or whatever we'll include in our show recommendations. Anything. Or asking for recommendations or telling us what you like about the show. Mm. Don't want to hear what you don't like.
Pictures of your video stores, video stores that are near you,
pictures
stuff like that.
Pictures of your pets.
Dressed as movie characters. Preferably.
But if not, that's fine. You can put your pet next to a copy of one of your favorite physical media discs.
Or your pet's favorite physical media disc.
Yeah, I would love to know what your pet's favorite movie is. How about that? You guys tell me that. viva@scarecrow.com. And then maybe I'll share my pet's favorite movies.
And don't forget to send us just real stuff, too. Postcards, mystery postcards, or whatever.
Yeah, don't forget to not deal with that nonsense and send us, like, authentic real stuff.
Send it to 5030 Roosevelt Way Northeast, Seattle, Washington, 98105.
He's got it.
I got it. Whew.
Or you can, if you're in the area, stop in the store. Maybe you'll see us. Or you can just, like, leave us a little note or just tell someone you said hi. And then, like, rent a movie and, like, check out the store, too, obviously.
Yeah. And if you're new to the show, say, hey.
Hey. In the comments. Mailbag. It's time for another...
another edition of...
Raunch versus...
Rom.
Ding, ding, ding. There's already going to be that sound.
Yeah, I do the ding, ding, ding. That's good. It's good for you to do it.
Thank you.
You can't have too many ding, ding, dings.
No.
So,
the results are in.
To do the results for last time, it was, what were the movies again?
Casual Sex versus...
Valley Girl. Right.
Casual Sex did get a couple of votes, mostly people who were intrigued by it. Yeah. A couple of people said they had had it on their list for a while, so maybe I gave you guys an extra push to watch it. It was a really good one.
And I watched it, and I liked it a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the clear winner of the last edition of Raunch versus Rom was Valley Girl.
Yeah.
Which I'm not mad about. That's a great movie.
We have new titles. We have two new picks for Raunch versus Rom. Two new competitors, if you will. So
in my corner of the ring, which is this corner of the ring, it's the Raunch corner of the ring. It is cheering section 1977. Harry Kerwin.
Yeah.
It's the top one.
And on a same disc with a King Frat, which is an awful movie. It's like a Z-grade Animal House ripoff. It is very hard to watch. If you like movies that have very extended fart contest scenes, King Frat is your movie. And in this corner of the ring is 1999's Drive Me Crazy.
On suggestion from me.
Directed by John Schultz and starring Melissa Joan Hart and Adrian Grenier. Grenier?
I say Grenier. All right.
Are you ready?
Sure.
All right. 3, 2, go.
So, cheering section, a late 70s raunch-com, is by the guy who directed a lot of crappy movies, most notably Barracuda, which I've never seen. This movie called Tomcats and a movie called God's Bloody Acre, which I feel like I've heard about. I think those last two are kind of like exploitative horror-ish movies. Mm. Maybe even Barracuda. This new girl comes to this high school and her dad is the football coach and everyone wants to like have sex with this new girl because she's really hot. And everyone in this high school is just ultra horny. Takes place in Florida, I think. And it's basically just kind of goes through this group of cheerleaders and football players' lives during the beginning of the school year. and they all just want to fuck. And there's some guys who love to like smoke weed in their van, and this guy puts stickers on the van to indicate the number of students that he's had sex with, which is kind of gross. This is really just kind of a creepy, kind of sleazy raunch-com where everyone is just trying to bang, but it shows some pretty good 70s fashion, and it starts with a great song titled Cheering Section, where they basically just repeat the title over and over again. There's a montage where this couple goes on a dune buggy ride through the woods, and then they, like, make out by the water. they do a stink bomb prank at one point. It's basically just like a high school sex comedy. There's some skate park and skating footage, roller skating footage. There's also definitely a bikini car wash because I cannot seem to get away from those. So they are raising money for the football team with their bikini car wash, and the rest is just a football game, basically. So that is cheering section, and check it out.
We'll see what I can do.
We'll see.
I put 2 hours in by accident.
Oh my God, if I had to talk about cheering section for 2 hours, I would kill myself.
All right. And go.
Okay, so Rom today is Drive Me Crazy from 1989 from director John Schultz and screenplay by Rob Thomas, not for Matchbox 20, but Rob Thomas, who created Veronica Mars and Party Down later on. And so different guy. So actually, when I saw his name in the credits, I was like, oh, actually, it might be pretty good. And indeed it was. It was actually more clever and fun than I was expecting. Based on a book called How I Created My Perfect Prom Date, originally it was titled Next to You, but it was changed to Drive Me Crazy because they wanted to use that Britney Spears song, Drive Me Crazy, which, there you go. You know the song. What else was this movie about? It's Melissa Joan Hart and Adrian Grenier play, high school people that live next door to each other. They were friends until like junior high when something happened. His mom died, and you know they aren't friends anymore or whatever. She wants to go out with this really hot football guy, and he's kind of like a weirdo who does his own thing, you know. But he's like a weirdo in the 1999 version, which is that he's a hot guy who has like other friends who are like slightly less attractive than him or
it's
whatever.
Like
they're real nerds. They're pulling pranks all the time at school and stuff. Anyway, through a series of events, she's like, I'm gonna go out with you. I'm gonna turn you into the perfect boyfriend, and you're gonna take me to the centennial dance, which is this dance she's been planning. Which is a weird thing where it's like a dance that doesn't exist anywhere else. But it was right around the millennium, so it's like, you know, 1999 or whatever. So I guess that was what the thing was. But it's not prom, but it's sort of like prom. Basically, it's fucking prom. Whatever. Anyway, they end up going to he ends up like, you know, through all of this. They're like, we shouldn't be together, but we're going to pretend we like each other. And of course, they end up liking each other, you know. And he's got a girlfriend played by Allie Larder, who was in a bunch of other stuff, but she was in Heroes, I remember. Anyway, it's really good, actually. A really charming, fun movie. And that's all I'm going to say. Yeah.
They were, like, I also just want to point out that I saw this movie when it came out, or like a year after.
Mm-hmm.
I was like probably like 10 or 11 when I watched it. And it's where I first learned the word centennial, and it also made me think that was a normal dance that high schools had.
Yeah,
it's not true.
But it is not. No, it is not. It is not a thing. Yeah.
So closing statements.
Yes, closing statements. All right.
Let's see what I didn't cover in my extensive coverage.
I didn't cover
much. Cheering section. I want to let you guys know that the taglines, because you know how I love taglines. Give me an F. Score, team, score. And then we'll throw up an actual detailed poster image, but one of the football guys is wearing a 69 jersey. You know that was on purpose.
Nice.
They go to a drive-in called Fonzie's 50s-style drive-in, which made me think we don't have, like, Y2K-style drive-ins, but that would be, like, a similar, like, 20 years before type thing.
Yeah.
And ends in a party where they wrap a girl in toilet paper. My last statement is, during the car wash, they just spray down a guy on a motorcycle. That's it.
Cool.
So, yeah. Vote for a cheering section.
Cheering section. Okay, so I got a couple things from Drive Me Crazy. So, like I said, this is based on the title is from the Britney Spears song, Drive Me Crazy.
I just can't sleep. I'm so excited. I'm in too deep.
So, you know the song. Not only is the music video for Drive Me Crazy on this DVD, but also another video for a band that I had completely forgotten about, or more likely didn't know about until this, from the late 90s, that epitomized the late 90s and early 2000s for me when I watched this video, called Jars of Clay, and it's called Unforgetful You. But you live through every tantrum, and you see it through every lie. And it is the most forgettable 1999 song and video you'll ever watch. It's perfect.
I feel like I mix up the name Jars of Clay with the other band Puddle of Mud.
That might be that, yeah. Well, you can't get a jar of clay without a puddle of mud.
That's true.
Also on the music front, there's a band in here called the Electrocutes, who are actually played by the band The Donnas, who I really like. The last thing I'll say is that the dad of Adrian Grenier is a guy who should have been played by Ray Romano, who would totally be played by Ray Romano now. I would have given this an extra half a star rating if the dad had been Ray Romano.
Who was the guy? Who's the dad, though?
Some fucking guy who looks like Ray Romano but isn't.
Oh.
Doesn't matter.
Okay. Let us know in the comments if you want to vote for cheering section.
Yeah.
Or...
Drive Me Crazy.
You be the judge. Ding, ding, ding.
All right, let's get into our picks.
Okay, you want to go first?
Yeah, I'll go first.
Okay,
let's
not?
Go first. That's... I mean, you know, I'm on my way out, so I'll go first. My first pick is a pretty new one. It's called Bad Luck Banging or Loony Porn.
What a title.
It is Romanian. The title maybe sounds better in Romanian, or maybe it sounds
maybe it's supposed good. To be like that.
It is. It does sound very silly. A teacher in this Romanian city, at the very beginning, there is an extremely graphic sex video that she makes with her husband, and then it goes into the movie, and the movie's basically broken into three different parts, and one of the parts is her essentially just walking around this city. You just get a feel for the city, and she's going different places and like talking on the phone with people and going like, what the video is what? You know, kind of like, you're just sort of getting this video.
Has gotten out.
Got out.
De un blog? Adică cineva a văzut, a salvat imaginele și le-a încărcat din nou? Și ce se poate face?
Yeah.
And then there's a second part that is called A to Z, and it's like all this stuff about Romanian history and culture and stuff in very sardonic, funny ways. Then the third part is her, the like principal of the school, and then the parents are all there, and it turns into this whole... Well, if you've watched any of these recent, like, community city council meetings or whatever, where people here, yeah, or idiots here are whining about whatever, it's a similar thing to that, where these people are just attacking her.
De budă. De veceu.
Alessia a zis că nici nu mai vrea să se mai căsătorească vreodată. Poate a rămas cu traume, eu știu.
Haideți, doamna Chico, și e doar un copil.
Păi tocmai, doamnă, că e doar un copil.
For all these different reasons. So that's basically the plot of the movie. I saw it was in Hulu, and I put it on. And I'll put up a screenshot of what they do on there. And as soon as it gets to the part where you see a dude's dick, at the very beginning of the movie, maybe like 30 seconds in, it like puts up this big thing that's like all the like hardcore stuff at the beginning is censored. And you know, people may question whether or not it needs the actual hardcore video she made at
I'm
the beginning of the movie.
I've
but
like
it's
seen
it's
dick on Hulu before.
But it's also very dumb, in my opinion. That, like Hulu shouldn't even have it on there if they're not going to show the movie in its full context, which is that you watch that sex tape, and then so by the end of the movie, when you're watching these people bitch and moan and to this poor woman about whether she's immoral for making this sex tape, you have seen it too, so you... In my opinion, you know, you go like, I'm with them, hopefully
also,
not, or against them.
Did we stick this on?
Intended for mature audiences. It is indeed intended for mature audiences, just based on that. And you see the video a couple other times played on phones and iPads later on when they're rewatching it. And of course, all the parents and stuff are all standing around, like, looking, leering at the video and laughing and stuff. It has three different endings where it's like, here's this ending, and here's how it would go this way. And then here's this ending, and I'm not going to spoil it, but it involves dildos. It is about a different culture. It's about Romanian culture, but it's also very like you watch it and it's very much like if you've read any of these transcripts of these people who like wanted to ban mouse from schools and stuff like that.
Yeah.
It's very much comes like one of those things. Also, it's during COVID. It takes place during like the pandemic.
Yeah,
and so
that's what I noticed.
There's a lot of
wearing masks.
There's a lot of masks and there's always people going like, put your mask up. Your mask is down. Your mask is under your nose and
that's
stuff like that. And it's really
I feel
funny.
Like, I don't know. I guess I haven't seen yet a lot of movies that acknowledge it in
mm-hmm.
a casual
yeah.
way like that.
Yeah. You know, I thought it was really fun. This says, astonishing, a daring and hilarious cinematic gamble.
I like
yeah.
the cover.
Okay. A masterpiece, sure. Playfully bonkers. Simultaneously raunchy,
Playfully
radical,
bonkers.
Satirical, and philosophical. Okay, yeah, I would say that.
All right.
Okay. An incendiary, playful, and wonderfully exasperated piece of filmmaking.
Okay.
Well, that's a lot, but oh yeah, okay, I would say that too.
Okay, you're
you
a
know,
writer, we get it.
I'm exasperated reading your film, your pull quote, but okay. But I would agree with most of those. Yeah, and I do love the cover. It's very,
yeah.
it's very
minimalist.
Like minimalist,
cool.
and you know, you get it. If you
it's a vagina.
Yeah, you get it. Check it out, and I honestly recommend checking out like a DVD copy of it if you can find it, because they fucking censor the Hulu one, and I think it's dumb. And
yeah. And to say fuck you to Hulu, we're showing the penis right here.
It is intended for mature audiences, so none of you immatures out there watch this.
Opa. All right, so I have one of my favorite movies. So mm-hmm. this is a rewatch. Both of these movies for me are rewatches.
What?
Which is a little
wow.
not my usual.
We're switching it up this time.
I know. They're kind of on theme too.
Cool.
About teenage best friends and the antics they get into. So, 1971's Don't Deliver Us From Evil. Which is directed by Joel There's two dots over the E, so is it Joel?
Joel.
Seria. 1971, Don't Deliver Us From Evil. It's a French movie. Mondo Macabro put it out. It should get a Blu-ray. That would be amazing. It's about, not like it should be getting one, but I think it should be. It's about two best friends named Laura and Anne who go to a boarding school in the kind of like the French countryside, and every weekend they go home and they hang out and cause trouble because all they want to do is sin.
Laura et moi éprouvons maintenant un plaisir de plus en plus intense à faire le mal. Péché est devenu notre principal objectif. Comme d'autres, les crétins passent leur vie sous le signe de la vertu.
They're like 13 or 14, but if you're watching this and you're like, I don't feel comfortable watching 13 and 14 year olds because it's a French European horror movie, yeah. So there's like some nudity. They were over 18 when they filmed this. They love getting into trouble. They love sinning and being bad. They're obsessed with Satan and they want to renounce Jesus Christ. They sneak into each other's beds and read like erotic fiction they found in like the attic of the boarding school, and they spy on nuns making out, and they set fire to like hay barrels and people's farms, and they seduce creepy old men and then like beat them up and stuff. And they just love getting into trouble. So their friendship is very obsessive with each other. It's kind of like a satanic heavenly creatures vibe, which nice. I super nice. Love. And then it ends up going too far. One of the girls, her parents are really rich and she has like a house in the back that she's turned into like her and her best friend's clubhouse, and they decide that they're gonna do a ritual where they get married to Satan. So they like steal a bunch of stuff from the church and they do this whole thing.
Nous t'implorons, ô Satan, notre maître et seigneur, fais que nous soyons toujours plus mauvais, aide-nous à accomplir le mal, et à l'heure de notre mort, accueille-nous dans ton antre infernal.
And basically they accidentally end up killing a guy, and then from there things just go south. Cool. And culminates in an amazing talent show scene, which I'm not going to ruin.
No, don't spoil anymore.
But I love this movie. It's really aesthetically pleasing to me. Also, I love female friendship movies and like seeing teens get into trouble, and this is definitely it.
You get it? Don't deliver us from you.
Don't deliver it. No. At first, it was just a game.
Nice.
And then it says, and lead us now into temptation. There's a couple like animal violence scenes in this, but you know, 1971, like European exploitation, you kind of gotta just take it. But yeah, this is one of my faves. So if you can get your hands on this and check it out, I'm not sure how available this is. So you might have to rent it or get your hands on a disc copy. So
yeah, it's from Mondo Macabro. They're good.
Yeah.
And so they're probably not streaming, but check their website. They usually, if it's not out of print, they usually have their stuff for sale up there too. So
yeah, I got a copy of this, but I think I got the copy on like eBay or something.
Ah, there
but
you go.
I was like, this seems like something that might go out of print, so I wanted to get my
Yeah, you never know with those.
It's one of my faves. So yeah, cool. Check out Don't Deliver Us From Evil.
Le jour de notre vie. Tout est prêt. Nous sommes allés acheter les robes ce matin et la répétition cet après-midi a très bien marché.
You got another movie? What?
I do have another movie, and it is a Russian film. It is called ILYA MUROMETS. AKA the bastardized version was Sword and the Dragon, and this one was MST'd, which is why Rich is clapping, because he's seen this. I have not seen this this MST. I'm going to throw this tape away, because yeah. I'm going to talk about the full version, which is also, you know, if you watch it from in a certain way, has a lot of silly stuff in it, but it's also an amazing fantasy movie. It's from Alexandr Ptushko. The only other movie I'd seen that I thought he directed, but found out he didn't actually direct, but it's in his director section, is a movie called VIY or V.
I love that movie.
Which he did. He did a lot of the. He actually directed a lot of the effects for it. So he did a lot of the.
Well, good
the
on
special
him
effects.
Because that movie is so fucking cool looking. Check it out.
And some of the other people did, somebody else actually directed it, but it is in his director's section. I think, you know, and so technically it's where it belongs because it feels like his other movies. But he did a lot of these epic, like, fantasy folklore movies about Russia. But he started in animation and then he went to live action. And there are these lavish fantasies with all these, like, creatures, and just the visuals are amazing, and every shot is like some kind of forced perspective. It's like a folktale of this guy, Ilya. He can't walk at first. He gets a potion, and he's like, I can walk again. People call him young man. He looks like he's like 40. I'm going to be the hero. He gets a sword from these wandering minstrels who are given a sword at the beginning by this giant fucking knight who turns into a... He gives them the sword and goes, give this sword to the true knight of the land or whatever, and then turns into a fucking mountain. And he catches this guy called the Nightingale Robber who, like, whistles. They say whistles, but he's, like, blows, and it, like, just blows everybody away. He becomes the center of all this palace intrigue where they're like, you can't trust him anymore. You know, these people are trying to betray the king, and he's actually the only, like, real true hero, him and his, like, other couple of friends. He, like, meets this woman and falls in love with her. There's this whole scene where she's, like, singing. And all these animals come up to her and stuff, and it's totally like a fairy tale. It's totally like straight out of like a Disney cartoon where the animals,
Snow White.
And she's, but it's like real animals. She has a son, you know, after she gets kidnapped by the bad guy, but it leads to like a father-son, you know, battle because he's been raised by the bad guy, and then Ilya gets like trapped in this, you know, prison for years. Best thing about it is like, I mean, the cut version is like shorter. It's like 70 minutes or something, 75 minutes or something, and this is like 94 minutes.
I might have to watch this.
And it's, there's so much that happens in it. It's so epic. There's a dragon in it and shit. Big battle scenes. And they're just great, like, you know, it's all this, like, these different kinds of special effects. And if you've watched this show, you know how much I love, you know, just different kinds of, like, crazy film trickery.
It says that it was the first Soviet widescreen motion picture participating in the shooting were 106,000 soldier extras and 11,000 horses, the record numbers in the history of world cinema.
Wow, I believe it. I believe it. There's these
epic shots. As of 1993, it was the record holding. I don't know, since.
Yeah.
But probably, actually.
Probably still.
Because computers and stuff.
Yeah, and there's a documentary, The Fairy Tale World of Him, of Alexandr Ptushko, is like this little half-hour special where these little kids are like watching thing about him. And then their mom's like, you gotta go to bed now.
And then we get to watch it.
And they go to bed, and then they're like, but they were so into it that then they're like thinking about it. And then they like, I don't know if they fall asleep, but they get swept up. And then they go into like dreamland sort of, and they're in scenes from his movies. Anyway, Ilya Muromets, I'm gonna watch the rest of these epics that he made now for sure.
So for my next movie in my sinful Sunday, Teenage Girls Gone Wrong, is the movie 13. Directed by Catherine Hardwicke, who you may know from directing the first Twilight movie. She directed Lords of Dogtown and some other stuff that I haven't seen.
You know, she was like an art director, right? Set director?
I don't know.
Before she became
maybe
a director? Yeah, she did like Three Kings and stuff.
Oh, that's cool.
Like she was like she was like the set designer for a bunch of movies like
Dang.
That. Yeah.
The movie came out in 2003. She co-wrote it with Nikki Reed, who is a co-star along with Evan Rachel Wood. They were both like 15 in this movie. Nikki Reed actually wrote this based on her like very recent at the time teenage experiences. Holly Hunter's in this movie as the mom of Evan Rachel Wood. Evan Rachel Wood plays Tracy, who is in the seventh grade. It's crazy because these girls are 13 in this movie, but they're so rebellious and stuff. You can't, like, in my brain, I'm like, 13, that's a baby. But anyways, Tracy goes to middle school and she sees the most popular, cool, hot girl, Evie, and she decides to try to be her friend.
Cute shirt. Thanks. Cute belt.
after school. We can go shopping on Mellis. Okay.
And she convinces her to, like, hang out with her by, like stealing this purse from this lady and is like, look, like, I'm cool too. And they are, like, shoplifting on Melrose. And then she kind of gets swept up in this rebellious teenage wave of doing drugs, drinking, sneaking out, having sex, and all this stuff. At the same time, Holly Hunter is like a recovering alcoholic who's a single mom to Tracy and her brother and is kind of having people come in and out of her house that are like friends. She's super caring. She breaks my fucking heart in this movie because she's like such a mom.
The bus never came, and then it did. I have to pee, and she hasn't eaten anything.
Well, that's okay. There's some stuff on the stove.
Oh, great. Okay, then we'll go.
Tracy, I'm sorry. I just haven't been to a meeting all week, and you know I need to go. But I really want to hear your poem. Come on.
No.
Please start over.
It's okay.
No, please. I really want to hear it.
She's so much struggling to connect because her and her daughter used to be really close, and then all this happens and she's just seeing this downward spiral in Evan Rachel Wood's life, and she's like trying so hard to connect. The opening scene of this movie is Tracy and Evie huffing keyboard cleaner and punching themselves in the face. And I remember this came out when I was 13 in 2003, and I remember watching this and just being completely aghast at everything. I was not this kind of 13-year-old.
That's funny.
It's very, very much like a Y2K, early 2000s, the feel of it. I think it was one of the first kind of like lower budget indie movies that I had ever seen, and it's filmed kind of like a music video. The movie gets progressively more and more diluted, I guess, in the lighting and everything to kind of match with the terrifying spiral that these girls are going down. This movie, I've seen a lot when I was younger, and I just rewatched it. I haven't seen it in a long time, and it holds up, and it's super heartbreaking, but it's also, like, really funny, very much a 2003 movie. And it's just, I think it's just really cool that one of the girls co-wrote it about her life. Anyways, check out 13. I feel like a lot of people kind of forgot about this movie. It's a good time until it's not, and then it's a good movie even so.
Right. It's funny that you mentioned that you saw it when you were young and you were aghast and it didn't, because that's exactly how I didn't see Kids till later, but Kids came out when I was in high school.
Yeah.
And I remember just seeing clips from it and hearing about it. I grew up in a completely different world from the world that movie takes place in, but I was like, as a kid going, as a teenager of that age, going like, that's not, you know, going like, no way. It's hard for me to believe. And then when I watch it, I'm like, well, obviously from this guy's experience, this is what it is. But
totally.
You know, but it's very similar, like, to where you're kind of like, oh, I can't believe what these kids are getting up to.
I got rebellious, like, later in my teens. But when I was 13 and saw this when it came out, like, I was at, like, a Catholic school. I was like, oh, my God, she just got her, like, tongue pierced and her belly button pierced. And they're like, what's acid? What's going on here? And everyone's wearing their, like, thongs way up in their jeans and stuff. Very 2003. But, yeah, it's awesome. It's a really good movie. The performances, like, Evan Rachel Wood and Holly Hunter, especially, them playing off each other is incredible.
Okay.
Check out 13. That also needs a Blu-ray release. Yeah. Doesn't have one.
No, I can't see that movie.
Why?
Because it's a gross, bloody war movie, and I'm a pacifist like Gandhi.
Why don't we just go see the Jack Black movie? The Misadventures of Ezekiel Balls, Ezekiel Balls, Ezekiel Balls, Ezekiel Balls.
Who let the dogs out?
Who let the... I just started singing the whole song. We did.
We did. But this time, also, cult indie provocateur Todd Solondz let the dog out. Specifically, the Wiener dog.
Wiener dog.
We're talking about Todd Solondz's Wiener dog.
2016, baby.
And if you are out there and you don't know who Todd Solondz is, he directed most controversially Happiness, but my favorite is, and will always be, Welcome to the Dollhouse.
Also my favorite.
One of the great and truest movies about teenage years of, like, that, like, middle school
Also, Don Wiener, excellent Halloween costume.
And I mean, Wiener dog, you know?
Yeah.
Don Wiener was also killed off in, like, what, palindromes, I think?
It was palindromes, yeah. Which Todd Solondz doesn't... He doesn't believe in his own canon,
no.
We'll say.
So, Wiener dog.
Yeah.
It's about a wiener dog.
It's about this dog who goes in and out of different owners' lives. Much like Red Dog, I guess, is the closest I was kind of thinking. Or Baxter.
Yeah, yeah. But it's like, but it's definitely like an anthology almost of like these different stories. But like the wiener dog is the impetus to tell stories about these different people.
And the wiener dog isn't much of a character in herself. She's great. It's not like in Red Dog where it's like, this dog changed my life, you know?
Yeah, oh yeah.
I don't know what that accent was. It certainly wasn't Australian.
No, it definitely wasn't, but it was close
G'day,
enough.
G'day, mate. This dog changed my life.
Let me tell you a story about how Red Dog showed up and changed everyone's lives forever.
There we go. You sound like Colin Frost.
So Wiener Dog starts with, how does it start?
Julie Delpy.
Well, it's Julie Delpy, yeah, and they get a Wiener Dog. Well, it's the great playwright Tracy Letts, who's also married to Carrie Coon, who was in Ghostbusters Babies and is in, like, Fargo Season 3 and, like, a bunch of... She's in The Leftovers. She's one of my favorite, like, actresses right now.
Keep naming things I haven't
but
seen.
Tracy Letts, the guy who plays the dad in that first segment, is the guy who wrote... He wrote August Osage County, and also Killer Joe and Bug, which are all based on plays.
Bug
he's a playwright.
Is one of my faves.
Yeah.
He's a dick in this, though.
Yeah, yeah. He plays a great dick.
They have a little boy who it's hinted at that he's probably just, like, in remission from cancer.
Yeah. He buys him a wiener dog.
He gets him this adorable, chubby little wiener dog.
And he
names her Wiener Dog.
Wiener Dog.
They keep her in the basement in a cage, like, at night, and the dad is like, he does this whole speech where he's like, a dog has to be broken.
Remy, you have to break a dog. Break their will. So that they'll submit to your will. It's a kind of civilizing. So they act like humans.
And Julie Delpy is like a seems like a miserable wife.
Oh, yeah.
She is not happy that they have a dog.
She's
either.
Incredibly bad at explaining any sort of concept to her child. She's just like,
where do you think they buried her?
I don't know. Actually, she was probably cremated.
What's cremated?
Sort of like put in an oven.
At some point...
They leave him alone.
Oh, yeah, and they have, like, the best time.
And it's really sweet. It's actually, the like, maybe the genuinely sweetest
the
scene
sweetest part in, the movie.
In any Todd Solondz movie, where you're like, this is genuinely just a couple of characters, in this case a boy and a wiener dog, having a great time.
They're, like, jumping on the
fight.
Bed. They're, it's, like, pillow fight with, like, feathers everywhere.
Then he feeds Wiener Dog some granola.
I just ate a granola bar. I should have had it for this.
Feeds Wiener Dog some granola. Then the parents come home and there is
shit everywhere.
Dog diarrhea everywhere. And let me tell you.
Kevin knows.
I had an experience because I do dog sitting when I'm not doing Viva. Took care of some dogs that were some dogs I've taken care of before. And when my friend left, she's like, one of the dogs
Kevin
is having some
feed them granola, by the
no,
way.
No, no, no.
This wasn't Kevin's
no,
fault.
No, this was not my fault. But I was taking care of them for a week. And first one of the dogs and then the other dog. And then seemingly both of the dogs had diarrhea all week. It was a waking nightmare. If you've never heard dog diarrhea coming out of a dog's butt at 1:30 in the morning, you are a luckier person than I. They're very. This was recent. This was recent.
Yeah, this
too.
Was like a few months ago.
Yeah, and so it was like this. Yeah, it was a little bit. And it was very. Their reactions to it was very realistic. Like cleaning up that mess is disgusting. And there was just so there's just and the dog walks through it at one point.
I did some of my own research. If you give a lot of granola to a dog, it might cause diarrhea. I don't think it's as toxic as this movie portrays. But don't try it at home, you guys.
I think
don't try to press it.
I think there was chocolate in that granola bar, though.
Like the one I just ate.
Yeah. So I think that was what did it. They should have said, the script should have said chocolate, but
like
it said
chocolate
granola.
Yeah.
Yeah. But anyway, he shouldn't have fed that dog that. As soon as he pulled it out, I'm like, do you want some? I'm like, don't feed that dog that. And I did not expect it to be a disgusting diarrhea mess. Well, anyway, there's some bloody diarrhea outside of the cage. And then the boy goes down there in some great car pajamas.
The dad had taken the dog
to
the vet.
And so Wiener Dog's going to get put to sleep. When she's on the table to get put to sleep, vet tech. Our girl Greta Gerwig, like, notices her and goes, I don't think you need to
sleep.
And she runs out of the office and takes Wiener Dog with her and nurses her back to health.
And she renames Wiener Dog Duty. We learn that she is Dawn Wiener from Welcome to the Doghouse.
What?
Welcome to the Dollhouse. In this case,
boy.
The Doghouse.
Oh, boy.
We have fun here.
She goes to a convenience store. And she runs into an old classmate played by Kieran Culkin, my favorite Culkin.
Hey, Wiener Dog.
Brandon McCarthy?
How's it going?
Wow.
Turns out the old classmate is Brandon from Welcome to the Dollhouse.
That's right, who was super... If you've
who
seen Welcome
like,
to the Dollhouse...
I'm going to rape you at 3 p.m. maybe after school.
She's like, shouldn't we catch up? They like talk about
and
a
he's
minute.
Like, he's like, we just did.
We just did. So she goes outside and she sees him like... playing with her wiener dog, and he's like, so she's like, oh, you like wiener dog, that's great. And he's like, hey, want to come to
Ohio
with me? And she's like, sure.
What's in Ohio?
Crystal meth.
Okay.
And then he's like, I'm kidding. But turns out he actually is.
He's not kidding. But also to go visit his brother.
And his brother's wife, who are both, they both have Down syndrome.
Yep.
They live together in a house, and they're really stoked to see him, and they love Wiener Dog, or Duty now. Kieran Culkin has to tell his brother that their father passed away in this really, like, touching, sad scene where it's, like, him trying to explain that the dad's not there anymore, and then the brother's, like, asking him, like...
Well, when's he gonna come visit?
Or whatever. And then he's like, you're not doing drugs anymore. And it's, like, he's classic Solondz, like, sad...
So... He died?
Sad shit.
Also, he says, I'm not doing drugs anymore, and we just saw a scene with him in a hotel shooting up.
Yeah. Dawn and Brandon, like, have some moments where it's like, oh, maybe they're gonna, like, hang out or whatever.
Yeah, maybe. It's probably not gonna end well
But then
for
they
them.
End up about to leave, and Dawn is like, let's the couple have Duty.
I'm gonna leave Duty with them, because they really loved her. And so
she likes her, yeah.
So she leaves Duty with them. And then...
We have an adorable intermission.
Oh, we have an intermission is next. Intermission. I love intermission.
Wiener Dog. Wiener Dog.
It reminds me of the song Ghost Riders in the Sky a lot, but it's...
It also reminds me of, if you guys ever watched the Nickelodeon show Cat Dog... It's similar to that.
Mm-hmm.
So intermission is over, and then we don't see how this dog becomes this next person's dog. No. But it's Danny DeVito.
What's his name?
Professor
Smirsch. He is a teacher at a college film school, and he's teaching screenwriting.
And he had a hit movie a long time ago, and he's been working on screenplays and trying to get them produced, but no one's really biting, and he's kind of washed up, and these new kids in his screenwriting class are all like, don't care about the old ways and all this stuff,
right.
And I think they can just make movies and blah blah blah, and he's kind of the old school of thought, and he's feeling a little
his big
down
thing,
in the dumps.
I think the movie is making fun of film school students more than the film school teacher.
Yeah, what is it? It's the whole
it's what if then what.
Yeah.
You know, that's the question.
There's a scene where this kid comes in to talk to him, and he's like, I just want to make a movie about, queer identity and blah, 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 blah.
You know what I'm going to say. You got to have a what if. Simple as that.
The kid's, like, really frustrated and, like, leaves, and then you see him talk to his other friends, and everyone's like, God, Professor Smirtz, he should just, like, leave. Like, no one likes
him. It's really, like, I'm going to start a petition to get him fired or whatever.
The school should get rid of him.
It's just, somehow everything he suggests seems totally lame. Like, it's all shtick.
But Danny DeVito is a sad character,
and he's at home alone with Wiener Dog.
With Wiener Dog.
But I don't know if we have a name for it.
I don't
for
remember.
Duty. It might still
remember.
Be Duty. Who knows?
I do know that the movie he made is called Apricots.
I think my favorite scene in the whole movie is in this segment.
They're interviewing for to get into the film school.
Yeah, get into the film school. Yeah. And Danny DeVito has to like sit and listen to these interviews. And they're asking this guy his favorite. First, they ask him like his influences. And he's like, oh, geez, no, I watch like so many movies. Like my influences range like far and wide. And then they're like, okay, well, like, what's your favorite movie? And he's like,
oh, boy.
There's so many movies. All sorts of genres. I really love all sorts of genres. And then they're like, what have you watched recently? And he's like, I couldn't even. It's countless. And then they're like, name any movie.
I know this is like a trick question, but there really are so many that I just can't keep track.
Please, just name a movie.
Any movie.
And honestly, like, that guy is me at some points. Like, working here when people ask me, like, to recommend something. God, there's so many movies. I just, it's just like, name one movie. And he's just like, I couldn't just name one. And it's like, dude.
But Danny DeVito's trying to get all these screenplays made. And he's calling his agent. The agent's like, it's really good news. For me, I've got a different job at a different studio.
Yeah, so I'm handing it to this lady.
So it's great. So now you're working with her. So good luck or whatever. Uh-huh. You know, so it's like nothing's going his way.
This new agent is like, yeah, I'm going to send your script to DreamWorks, which is, I thought was kind of weird.
Yeah.
And then he's like, okay. But then like he can't get a hold of her ever again after that. And like he hears all the students talking shit about him.
And then the best part of the movie.
And then the best part happens.
Happens where
he... You see him get an idea, and he's like, yeah, okay. And then he's, like, out shopping, and he's holding up these little dresses. And then he's, like, finds a yellow one, and he's like, yeah. And you're like, oh, my God, is he buying a wiener dog, like, a cute little dress?
You almost think it's, like, oh, he's turning around, and he's just going, like, you know what? I'm just going to live my life. Then he has the meeting with we talked about earlier with the kid saying, like, I just want to make a movie about identity or whatever. Yeah. Danny DeVito goes to the elevator.
And they're like, oh, shh. Like,
no, shh. A few minutes later, they're like, what? What is that? And then, like, you see Wiener Dog walk out wearing a yellow dress, but with a bomb strapped to her.
It's fucking amazing. Like, I want this to be my dog's Halloween costume, is Wiener Dog in this bomb dress.
Louise would look
dress.
Great in that bomb
she
dress.
She would look great in that bomb dress.
She would look great in that bomb dress.
Like, waiting at the elevator. The dog's just waiting at the elevator.
Just wearing a bomb dress. And then, so then it's just, like, cuts to, like, the bomb squad and this guy in a bomb squad suit. He reaches out to her, and it just goes, and it just cuts to like a like brown screen. But you don't ever see any smoke or anything from. So I don't.
No, but they arrest Danny DeVito though.
Oh yeah, he shows up again, and they arrest him. They look at his ID, and they go, "Are you this guy? Wait, this is you?" And he goes,
"What if I am? Then what?"
So then we come to our last segment.
Our last segment with.
Ellen Burstyn.
And well, my favorite girl from Girls.
Oh, yeah, Shoshana.
Shoshana, Zosia Mamet.
So we open up to Ellen Burstyn smoking a cigarette with, like, sunglasses on, yeah. Sitting outside in her garden next to Wiener Dog, who we find out later she has named Cancer.
Cancer.
Why would you name it that?
It felt right.
She lives in her house with her, like, helper, kind of like a nursing aide named Yvette. And Yvette has an amazing pink tie-dye shirt that says The View on it, which I fucking loved. She's waiting for Zosia Mamet to come over to have lunch or dinner. And,
yeah.
And then we see her come out of the car with her boyfriend, Fantasy. You find out that, like, she hasn't visited her grandma in a few years. Ellen Burstyn is just, like, barely speaking back to her, clearly thinking her granddaughter is nuts.
He actually finds these dead animals, and he embalms them, and then he sort of roboticizes them into these, like, audio sculptural sort of...
I'm interested in mortality.
Yeah. I mean, his work is... very exploratory, very controversial.
It's like, what do you want?
How much do you want?
But that was after Fantasy went outside.
And Fantasy goes outside and is like watching like a hot girl walk by and is like yanking the dog around.
She asks for like $10,000 to fuel one of Fantasy's projects.
Yeah, and also that she's not a drug addict anymore, but she is going to be playing a crackhead in a movie. And so she's good because she's got a role.
Yeah.
Wiener Dog is not in this segment a lot.
No, she's outside. And then she comes back in with Fantasy and Ellen Burstyn writes
a check. She writes a blank check, and she goes, like, you left the amount blank, and she's like, I don't know, I can't fill it anymore. She's, like, fed up. She is,
she's like,
I don't care. I'm gonna die soon. What do I care? Steal all my money.
They give her an ostrich egg, and she gives it to Yvette, really, and Yvette crams it down the garbage disposal.
And then we get to the scene where this really cool scene where Ellen Burstyn, like, looking around.
There's these red-haired girls,
and they keep saying, like, I'm you.
If you ever liked other people, and you, if you'd ever liked yourself, you, if you'd left bigger tips.
She's like, I don't want to die. Like, I don't want to die.
I don't want to die now. And then she wakes up, and it's all a dream.
Wiener dog's not there anymore. Or cancer is not
there. Cancer is not there. And cancer is, in fact, running out into the road. And I'm not going to show this. And cancer gets... Run over.
And you see it.
Cancer gets run over.
And then cancer gets run over again and again and again.
Cancer gets run over several times.
And it's just, like, splooting out. It's really upsetting. I watched her get run over once, and then I turned my head for the rest
of it. And here's the thing. Look, I knew who made this movie.
Yeah, you know? I know.
What's the joke in Natural Born Killers about the rattlesnake, where it's like, yeah, the rattlesnake bites you and it's like, you knew I was a snake, right? I knew I was going to get bit, and I did.
I know. And Kevin had texted me and told me I really wasn't going to like this.
I think you're going to hate this one part, in fact.
That had to happen in order for the next scene to occur.
Which actually I think is funny.
I think it's pretty
the
funny.
The very last scene. And so then it's like several months later or whatever, and we're at like this art opening.
Turns out it's fantasy's art opening.
And then it's like, you know, kind of panning around the crowd or whatever. And it pans over to this one exhibit, and it's, a case on the wall. And it's Wiener Dog. A taxidermy robot Wiener
apparently
Dog.
That's what the money that Ellen Burstyn gave Fantasy for his art. Oh boy, what a film. So I couldn't find the name of the dog, but I found an interview on Collider.com with Todd Solondz, and he said, I love working with actors. I do. I think all of the actors were very excited to work on the movie, and they were all charmed by the dog. But by the end of the first day of shooting with the dog, they were ready to start counting the days until it was over. The dog was such a nightmare. I love working with actors. If you cast the right person, the right part at the right time, they make you look like a better writer and director than you really are. I learned from the ASPCA that this breed is very much bred for the marketplace at the expense of its well-being. Consequently, there's a deficit in intelligence.
Wow.
They worked with about 3 to 5 different dachshunds, and they were all remarkably stupid, is what he says. They didn't respond to any command.
Holy cow, I love it.
They had to rewrite a lot of material to accommodate its inadequate intelligence. I don't really appreciate how Todd's talking about this dog. For the interlude, I put it on a treadmill, and then the crew sat around for about 3 hours until we finally got 12 seconds of usable footage. So it was not fun working with a dog. I love dogs, but I definitely don't think there will be any sequel here. I guess the dachshunds they used were not, like, trained actor dachshunds.
No.
It sounds like they just grabbed some dachshunds.
They just found some dachshunds and were like, yeah, should be easy, right? And then they were like, no.
I love that they sat for 3 hours with the dog on the treadmill to use 12 seconds of, like, footage that they just ran
they just
in a
looped.
Loop for the intermission.
That's awesome. That makes me like that intermission even more.
Oh boy.
All right, Wiener Dog. Should we do pause? Yeah, how many paws?
3 paws out of 4.
Okay.
How many paws for you?
I give it 3.5. I was, like, really into it until that scene where Wiener Dog gets run over.
Yeah, yeah.
And then it was more like, it wasn't so much that Wiener Dog got run over and killed, it was more like it was too much.
The excessiveness.
It was a little like, it is too much. Because up to that point, it was like, is this Todd Solondz's nicest movie? Is this, like, his nice movie?
It is until it isn't.
And I mean, as much as that, nice is doing a lot of work in that sentence, too. Like, it's, like, not... It's not... It's a Todd Solondz movie, so it's not nice. But it's, like, is this his nicest movie?
Right.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe. Up until that point, anyway. Yeah. And then it's sort of like, oh, no, okay, I remember what movie we're watching.
I recommend you guys check it out, though.
I liked it.
Hilarious. Marks the strangest, fantastical moment of Solondz's whole career. That's bold, but okay. We have something a little different for next time.
We do. We have a movie that had been...
The people have been just begging. The crowds have demanded that we cover this movie.
You're sort of not wrong. It's Love on a Leash.
I'm scared.
Love on a leash.
You want dog food?
Yeah, I'm a dog, genius.
This is going to be a little lighter of a romp, but maybe perhaps the same level of unsettling.
There's two quotes on the back here. The princess and the frog meet Pinocchio.
The fuck?
A cute drama for every animal lover. I doubt that, too.
What is two movies? Hurry up. Like, Princess and the Frog meets Pinocchio. They have elements of magic and changes.
It looks like this lady's going to marry this dog. We're going to watch it so you don't have to.
So, Love on a Leash. Tune in next time.
Oof. Woof.
Woof. Okay. Anything in there?
Mm-mm.
That we need?
Nope. Bucket's empty.
I guess we're done with all the movies. We're never talking about any movies ever again.
That's it. No, we're still going to talk
kidding.
About more movies.
Yeah,
we're I'm not gone that. Yet.
And you're still going to talk about movies while you're gone. Maybe not
yeah,
to us.
To the chagrin of Sophie, who I'll be traveling with. I'm sure she'll stop talking about movies so much. Well, you're the only person here, so you get to hear about all the movies and stuff.
If you have any recommendations of places that Kevin should check out while abroad, please send us viva@scarecrow.com.
For sure.
That's cool.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks for watching our 41st episode.
Yep.
As always, like this, share it with your friends and family, followers.
Yep.
If you're like an influencer with like a million followers, you should share us. That'd be so cool.
Absolutely.
Comment below.
Yeah.
Stuff. Vote for Raunch versus Rom. Mm-hmm.
Check out our podcast, Scarecrow Radio. Check out Soundtrack Cinema with Mark Steiner. And click the links below to find out more information about Operation Bigfoot. He has a whole photo montage of how he put together the cool shelf and stuff.
Our Letterboxd list of all the movies we've covered, so you can go back and see what there is to see. If you're in the neighborhood, come by Scarecrow. And if you're not in the neighborhood, go to our website. You can rent by mail. We'll send you some stuff. Thank you.
Thanks again.
And we'll see you next time.
Out.
Viva Physical
Media. Bye.
Wiener dog, wiener dog. She soldiers on where angels fear to tread. Wiener dog, wiener dog. Just looking for some shelter.